But I wanted to just briefly re-mention that we are doing this new Sunday rhythm. We are having these all-age services every kind of first Sunday of the month, and they won't always look exactly like this, but they should be, you know, quite interactive. They should be a lot of fun, and they should there should be something for everyone. And you know, it doesn't mean that everything in the service is going to be, you know, perfect for you and the way that you engage with things. But it should mean that you know, at some point in the service, there should be something. You know, that kind of hits the spot for you, that you can engage well with, something that will, you know, nourish you, enrich you, and build you up and challenge you and stretch you in a way that works for you, that engages with you. So that's what we're doing on these first Sundays. But there's also something else you should know about these first Sundays, that we're going to be going through looking at our church values. And you might remember back, you know, at the start of the year, we kind of came out of this booklet about our vision, our values and beliefs. And maybe you've read it, maybe you haven't. But in there are kind of 9 values that we have as a church. And we figure it's kind of, you know, not much use just kind of declaring, you know, saying here are our values. We actually want our values to not just be, you know, words, things we say, but to actually become, you know, part of us, part of who we are as a church. And so we're going to be kind of looking at each one, digging a little bit deeper on these all-age service Sundays. And so that means this month we're going to start with the first one, which is all about us being a generous church. And I'm just going to read what we have written in this booklet. And so we want to be a generous church, and that means that all of us have something to offer. Every single person, we all have something to offer, and it means that we want to be open-handed with our lives, our time, our resources, our gifts, our abilities, and our hospitality. So it's, you know, it's not just money, like we might often think, like, you know, that's an easy one to go to, but it's all of our lives. We want to be generous with everything that we have, all of who we are. And we want to be generous, you know, to God and to other people, the people around us. And before I get into that a little bit more, I wanted to do a little bit of an interactive activity with everyone. And we don't normally do this, but I'm going to say, if you have, you know, a phone on you, this is the time to get it out, because I'm going to do something that's actually, we're doing Generous Church, my bad, I'm behind on my presentation. What we're doing an interactive thing. I've got a presentation, and through scanning that QR code, you just get your phone camera and scan it, or you could go to the website, menti.com, and put in that 8-digit number code, and it'll take you to the same place. But what that's going to do is it's going to let you kind of join in on the presentation, and I've got just a couple of kind of questions where we're going to put some answers in together, and it will come up on the screen. So when you've joined the presentation, when you've kind of scanned the QR code, or you've put in the website and the numbers, then why don't you get, there's a little like thumbs up icon that you can tap. So why don't you tap that, and then you can see people. There we go. That was quick. Loads of thumbs up coming up on the screen. So that just lets us know how many people we've got. You don't have to do this, by the way. This is just a bit of fun. Okay. If anyone else wants to join in, the kind of the website and the number code will stay at the top. But I just wanted us to kind of gauge how generous we all kind of feel. Everyone in the room this morning, how generous we feel. And the way I'm going to do that is I've just got a sort of sliding bar for you to vote on. It's kind of 0 to 10. You know, how easy do you find it to be generous? Do you find it really easy? Are you like, you're super generous? It's just so natural. It's just, you know, every day. Yeah, just, you know, take my money, take my clothes, or, you know, whatever, you know. Anyone asks you for anything, you just, yes, yeah, I want you to have as much as you want. Or do you actually find it really a bit more of a challenge? Is it actually a struggle? You have to be, you know, more intentional to be generous, or you have to really fight, you know, your desires for, you know, what you want to, in order to be generous. So just kind of vote on that. It will kind of show us where we are. There's a bit of an average going on, and that's actually quite nice. You know, most of us, it's a bit more natural to be generous, and well, I mean, my suspicion is that's the work of God, because if we're all really honest, it's easier to be selfish. It's easier to, you know, focus on ourselves and what we want to do than it is on other people and on being generous and giving. But It's very encouraging to see that we're feeling fairly generous in the room today. But I wanted us to just think about, not to kind of try and be negative, but to think about what makes it hard to be generous. So I've got another question, kind of, this is more open-ended, it's not voting, but you kind of write an answer. So the times when it is harder to be generous, what is it that makes it harder? Whatever comes to mind, just write down a response. It's all anonymous, by the way. We're not going to know who you are. I'm not going to come and be like, you, why do you find it so hard to be generous? Let's pray for you. So just whatever comes to mind, just write it down. You can do multiple answers, you know, if your kids want to say something, they can submit an answer as well. You can also vote on one if you're like, actually, that's exactly the words that I, you know, would have used. You can vote on them as well, I think. So lots of different things, selfishness, busyness, time, not liking people, feeling rushed, people wasting what you give, lack of actual resource, you don't have much to give in the first place, fear, pettiness, maybe someone hasn't been very nice to you, people being rude, demanding that you help them, not actually asking. So it is, while we might feel, naturally generous, there are loads of reasons, loads of things that make it hard to be generous, whether that's to do, with internal stuff we have going on, whether that's to do with, other people and the way they are with us. And you can keep submitting answers, and you can keep looking at those for a minute. But, it bring up the point that it is much easier to be generous to other people when, they're generous to us. When they're nice, it's much easier to be nice to people when they're nice to us. I actually had my birthday yesterday. I turned 25. Thank you. It kind of caught me off guard. I wasn't really ready to turn 25, but it was great. But I had a great day, and I spent the day with my wife. But then at the end of the day, I thought we were just going home. But we swung by the church because she claimed to have left something here. And there was actually a surprise party for me, which was so lovely, because no one's ever done that for me before. And so everyone in the room who was there, who helped out, I just want to say thank you, guys. That was so lovely. And, now that you've all been generous to me, I'm ready to be so generous to you guys. I'm ready to, anything you ask of me, I'm happy to just give to you. But that is sort of the way it works, when people are generous to us, it's so much easier just to be generous back. But Jesus talks about this point. He says, he kind of talks to it, but it's a challenge, actually. He says, what credit is to you when you love people who, love you back or have loved you first? Because everyone does that. It's our natural nature as humans to love the people who love us back. What the kind of love that changes the world is when we love people who can never love us back, the people who actually scorn us or don't like us. Loving them, that when people see that kind of love, flowing out from us, that's what changes the world or makes people question how is that possible. And so I think that's kind of what I was thinking about this morning: being generous, not just in a way that's expected or normal, and not giving what's expected or the bare minimum, but think giving to people who can never give back to us, people who can't repay us, or giving in a way that we never see the effects of the giving, often it's easier to give to people in person, when you give presents and stuff, we see the joy in their face and stuff like that, but when we give to charities and things overseas or just give away our things to some, food bank or something, we never see the results of that. It's much harder to, do it with the same amount of joy that we might do otherwise. And what we're going to do, what I'm going to talk about this morning is I'm going to look at Luke chapter 24. So if you have one of these bad boys, feel free to turn to Luke 24. Or on a phone, you might have a Bible app on your phone that you can turn to, that you can use that as well. But that's what we're going to be looking at this morning, which isn't a very normal passage to talk about when thinking about generosity. I fully admit that. But I'm blaming God on this one, because I did have an incredible talk prepared all about generosity, and I something happened on Friday, and I just really felt strongly that he told me not to preach that talk. So this is what we've got this morning. And but we are still focusing on generosity, and I think it's actually definitely the message that we need this morning. And so, you know, feel free to turn to Luke 24 to find it. But what I just wanted to start off with was a question. Because as I was saying, you know, it's easier to, you know, be generous when we know someone loves us and we love them. So I wanted to kind of ask you the question of, are you in love with God? Is that how you describe your relationship with God? I think it's a really important question for us to ponder on. Are you in love with God? You know, do you spend time with him regularly, zealously? Are you eager to spend time with him each day? You know, I just wanted us to kind of imagine what it would look like maybe for 1 week if we all left this morning absolutely head over heels in love with God. If we all left here saying to God, look, I absolutely love you and I trust you. I trust you. I want you to do whatever you want in my life this week. Whoever you want me to go and love, I'm going to go and love them. Whoever you want me to be generous to, I'm going to go and be generous to them. Whoever you want me to spend time with, whoever you want me to talk to, just show me and I'll go and do it and I'll be generous to those people. I just want us to imagine what would happen in our community in Southcote and Aylesbury if, you know, this many people in this room, I don't know how many we have here, like 60, 70 of us, just absolutely in love with God, doing exactly what God wants us to do every single moment of the next week. This, you know, town would be absolutely transformed. That is the reality. It would be transformed. If we did everything that God wanted us to do this week, this city would be transformed. It's a town. I'm getting ahead of myself. But this would be completely different place if we were actively sharing God's love every moment this week. I believe that's what God wants, you know, a group of people. That's what he wants from his church, a group of people who are surrendered to him, who say, look, I want to do whatever, I trust you, that you know best. You know, if God is God, he does know best. He knows what's best for us, and he knows what's best for the people in our lives. And he wants a group of people who are surrendered to him. I think that's what would transform our town. That's what would, you know, bring about God's kingdom. That's exactly what would bring about God's kingdom. A group of people saying that we trust him. So that's the question for us to think about. Because when we know that God loves us, and I'll talk a bit more about that in a few minutes, when we know that God loves us, and when we are so in love with him as a response, generosity is just, you know, the natural overflow in our life. It's just so normal. Every moment we're just, you know, we understand that, you know, nothing really is our own when we're in love with God. If we've got God, we don't need anything else. If we've got God and, you know, we then, if we've got God, nothing else matters. If we've got God, it's like saying, you know, someone offering you, it's like someone offering you, would you like £1 billion? Or would you like £1,001,000? It doesn't really matter. It doesn't, it's not really going to make much of a difference which one of those you have asking, you know, do you want God or do you want God and everything the world has to offer? It doesn't really matter. As long as we've got God, that is what matters. And, okay, I'm going to get onto the passage. I'm going to read through the passage and then just go through it in little sections. So, I'm going to read Luke 24, verses 13-35, which is about, this is part of the Bible, it's chaptered, titled in my Bible, called The Road to Emmaus. Are you in love? I'm not really on it with my presentation, but It's called The Road to Emmaus. Emmaus is this little town near Jerusalem. And so what's happened is Jesus, he's died. He's been, spoiler alert, if you didn't know, Jesus dies. And he's risen again, or at least some of his followers, his disciples, claim that he's risen again. They've said, look, he's come back to life. Some angels have told us this. And everyone's like, you know, that doesn't sound right. That sounds like nonsense. And so there's these two disciples who are on a walking from Jerusalem to this place called Emmaus. And this is where we come in. Luke 24, verse 13. It says that the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus. It's about 7 miles from Jerusalem. So they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it's the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us what they had seen, that they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are and how slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 disciples just and those with them assembled together, and they were saying, "It's true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Okay. This is a great passage, but it's probably not the normal passage we'd go to if we were talking about being generous. But I think it talks a lot about how God sees us, how God relates to us, and I think that's really important that we get that when we're thinking about being generous, because we're going to be generous towards God when we understand how much He cares about us, how much He loves us and wants us and wants to be with us, and then when we're generous towards God, then it becomes natural and normal for us to be generous with everyone else around us. So I think that's sort of the order that we work with. So this passage is talking about these two disciples. They're walking this 7 mile walk on, along this dusty, rough terrain, talking about everything that happened, about Jesus, dying. They weren't expecting him to die. They thought amazing stuff was about to happen, but then he dies. And then some of the women were saying that he'd been risen. And I just love that they were talking about everything that had happened, that they were talking about what Jesus had done, what he'd done in their lives, what they'd seen him do for other people's lives. And I just love it. I'd love that to be more normal for me. I don't know about you. I'd love to just talk more naturally just about what God has done in my life. To just, in normal everyday conversations with people, just to, talk about what God does, what he's done in my life. I just love that that's what they were talking about. And it makes me want to do that more. But the really interesting thing I find in this passage is that they were kept from recognizing Jesus. And I don't know exactly how that worked. I don't know if, Jesus was wearing some disguise, or he just had a hood on, or he just, looked different after he'd been resurrected. We don't really know. But something that I think it does point out to us is that very often, in our lives, when Jesus comes alongside us, it's often in ordinary ways that we don't recognize. So I think we often don't recognize how close he is. and that we can just often not realize it's Jesus with us. And obviously, you know, we're told that he's with us all the time. He's always with us. But the reality is that most of the time, it's not obvious that he's with us. It's not like we, you know, have him in the flesh with us. I sometimes think, wouldn't that be amazing? Having Jesus literally in the flesh, walking hand in hand throughout my life. I think that would make it so much easier to be a Christian. But Jesus actually said it was better that we don't have that. He said it was better that he left and that we get filled with the Holy Spirit, that we are then empowered with the same Spirit that Jesus had. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is in us. Jesus said that was better for us, and that we have God's Spirit in us. He said that was better for us. And the passage carries on, and it always makes me laugh when I read it, when I think about it. Because Jesus asked them, you know, what they're talking about. Obviously, they're talking about him. He asked them what they're talking about, and he always does this and asks people questions that he knows the answer to. But he asked them what they're talking about, and then the one named Cleopas, he says, I mean, he doesn't realize it, but it's the most outrageous thing he could say. He says, are you the only one, not the only one visiting Jerusalem, who doesn't know the things that have happened there in these days? Which is hysterical, because Jesus is the only one on the whole planet who really does know what has just happened in Jerusalem. He's the only one who really does get what it means that he died and rose again. So Cleopas, it was, you know, that's something that we'd expect maybe from Peter, but I don't know about Cleopas. They obviously had no idea it was Jesus. But then, you know, Jesus, he keeps asking them. He asks them more about what they're talking about, that he keeps asking them these questions. And I think that's because he desires connection with people. He desires relationship. He doesn't just come and fix everything and say, you know, because if I was Jesus, I don't know about you, but if I was Jesus and I just died, then been raised back to life, my instinct wouldn't be, okay, I better hide myself so that my followers who know me really well don't recognize me. My thought would be, you know what, I better let as many people know that I'm alive as possible, because that's going to get the word out. It's going to get the message across. So I'll be like, you know, popping out saying, hey, it's me. I'm not going to be hiding myself so that they cannot recognize me. The people who've spent 3 years with me, you know, that doesn't make sense. It's not the best business model, Jesus. But one reason, I think, certainly, is that he desires relationship. He desires connection with people, his followers. He desires us to come to him with our questions. He desires that we actually talk to him. And I think that's something that is super important for us, as followers of Jesus, that we spend time with him regularly, zealously, that we run to him with our questions, or whether we have questions, whether there are just other things that we want to talk to him about, or we just want to tell him about our day. He desires to hear from us. I remember being like a little kid, and it would be like the end of the school day. I was in like primary school sort of at the time. It'd be the end of the school day, and I'd be just waiting, by like my the door, waiting for my dad to kind of get home from work. And the second I saw the car get into the driveway, I'd be sprinting out the door, running to the car. The second he opens the door to the car, I'm in his arms before he can even get up. And you know, I mean, this universal dad thing, he'd then throw us in the air. We called them wahees, because that's the noise we made, wahee, when he threw us up. Me and my sisters absolutely loved it. It was one of the best times of the day, filled with joy. We were just so excited for our dad to come home. And obviously, I'm not a dad. I don't know what it's like to be on the other side of that. But I'm sure that that is how God wants us to respond to him, as his little kids, running to meet him, to jump into his arms, to be so excited to spend time with him. They've been waiting all day for this moment to spend time with him. I I'm sure that that is how God sees us. When he tells us he is our good father, that we are his kids, that we've been given his spirit, that we naturally should cry out, Abba, Father, Daddy, that's what it means. It is good and right to have an intimate father-child relationship with God. And they carry on in the passage, talking about what's going on. They were saying, and he finishes by saying that, you know, the women said that he'd been risen from the dead, the disciples went and found it just like they said, but they didn't see Jesus, which just reminds me that neither do we. I don't think anyone in the room has actually seen Jesus. If you have, please tell me, because I want to hear that story. But I don't think any of us have actually seen Jesus. But one day we will. One day we will. And I guarantee you it's going to be the best day of your life. We're going to see Jesus one day. But for now, we kind of follow his clues. We get to read his word. We get to pray to him. We get to be filled with his spirit. Things that point us to Jesus. But I want to focus on the fact that we get to read this book, all of which points to Jesus. That's what Jesus goes on to explain to these disciples next. He says, didn't the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As Christians, it's not a bad thing, but it's really easy to focus on the New Testament. Naturally, you know, it's got the Gospels, the Acts of the Apostles, the letters, kind of books of the Bible that we're more familiar with usually. And that's not a bad thing. It's great. We should focus on those. We should read the New Testament. But for me, certainly, it's often been the neglect of the Old Testament. Aside from all the stories you hear in Sunday school, you know, David and Goliath, Daniel in the Lion's Den, Noah's Ark, aside from those stories, I until a few years ago, really didn't know what was in the Old Testament. That's the truth. But Jesus says clearly here that all of this book is about him. All of it concerns him. And something exciting, I think, that we get to do as Christians is we get to read the Old Testament and see which bits of it are pointing towards to Jesus. Which bits are those clues about what the Messiah was going to be like? We get to read about the kind of sacrifice system that they had going on, where, you know, they would sacrifice animals so that they could be forgiven for their sin. Often they would sacrifice lambs. And, isn't that just pointing towards the perfect Lamb of God who would suffer and die for us, that we'd be made clean? We get to read about the new covenant that was prophesied. There were prophecies about a new covenant where God was going to write his laws on our hearts and give us new hearts and change us. How else is that possible without Jesus, without the cross, without the resurrection and him filling us with the Spirit? We get to read about Abraham and Isaac. When Isaac's about 30, Abraham takes him and he takes him on this walk up a hill. He puts the wood on his back that he's going to get sacrificed on. And they go up this hill in a similar region to where Jesus went up a hill carrying the wood on his back when he was about 30. There are just these crossovers between the Old and New Testament. It's all connected. We read about Moses leading an entire nation out of slavery into the freedom, the promised land. And then we find Jesus leading the whole world out of slavery to sin into the freedom and glory of God's kingdom. We read about Jonah, who went into the belly of a fish for 3 days and came out changed. That sounds to me like Jesus, who went into the belly of the earth for 3 days and came out glorified. It's all about Jesus. It is all about Jesus. And then they carry on. They get to where they're going. They get to the village. And they say, Jesus, he continues on as if he were going further. So I don't actually know what would have happened if they didn't invite him in, because they say, stay with us. But Jesus clearly wanted them to invite him in, because it says, as if he were going further. They wanted him to stay with them. They had such a great chat. Such a great conversation. But they were also inviting him in, being generous, saying, look, it's nearly evening, you shouldn't carry on. Come stay the night with us. We'll feed you. You can sleep here. And Jesus doesn't force his way into our lives. He didn't say, I'm going to stay with you. He waited for them to invite him. And I think God often waits for us to invite him too. He waits for us to invite him deeper into our lives. If there's areas of our lives where, you know, we're not seeing much stuff going on, we're not seeing, maybe we have areas where that we're struggling in, breakthrough. Maybe there are things that we struggle with. Maybe it's just something more simple, like at work, I would love if it was easier to have conversations with my coworkers or at school with friends. Maybe it's those sort of things. Maybe what's missing is us inviting Jesus, saying, look, I actually really want to intentionally take you with me to those places that I go to, God. I want you to come with me. Would you help me? It's as simple as just praying and asking him. He has filled us with his spirit. We have everything we need. But God often waits for an invitation. And he wants us to want him. That is what is abundantly clear from the scriptures. There's a really interesting part in Exodus where they've Moses with the nation, he's helped take them out of slavery. And what happens is they don't know who God is, so they make these idols and start worshipping them, and God has literally given them commandments saying, don't do this, you can't make an image of me to worship me, that's not me. And so he says to Moses, look, what's going to happen is you're going to go into the promised land. It's this incredible land flowing with milk and honey, everything you could possibly need. In fact, I'm also going to send an angel ahead of you to drive out your enemies. You're never going to have any of this conflict. It's going to be perfect. The land's going to be good for you. But I can't go with you. And I don't know how you would respond in that situation. Maybe an easier one for us to think about that. John Piper talks about, and I'm going to paraphrase it, but he says, if you could have heaven, you go to heaven right now, all of your friends, your family would be there, all the people that you love most in the world, they're going to be there, there's never going to be pain, there's never going to be sickness, everything's going to be good, you're going to have every, you know, desire fulfilled, but you won't have Jesus. Do you think you'd be satisfied? That's the sort of question for us to think about. And I don't know what you would say to that, but Moses said he would not be satisfied. He says, God, if you don't go with us, don't send us away from this place. That is not good enough. We need to have you. What else on this earth is going to distinguish us from everyone else? We have to have you. That's more important than all of those other things. What do we want? Do we want God, or do we just kind of like his stuff? Do we just like his gifts and his blessings? The next thing that happens is they broke bread. They gave thanks. We're going to do that in a minute. And I'm going to try and hurry up because we don't have very long. We're going to do that in a minute, though. And they break bread. They suddenly realize it's Jesus. And then he disappears. Again, wouldn't be my business model. But that's what he does. He disappears. And they're suddenly like, this is crazy. That was Jesus. And they realize that they've been with him for the last however long, several hours on this long walk they were on. And they say, weren't our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road? And I don't know about you, but I want that burn. I want to be burning constantly because I've spent time with Jesus. That's how we get that. If you want your heart to be burning with passion for God, it comes out of spending deep time with him, slow time, meditating, praying, reading the words in this book. And the next thing they do is they leap up and they run. It doesn't say they run. In my head, they're always running. But they go back to Jerusalem. They straight away immediately go back to Jerusalem, which we've, you know, read earlier. It's a 7-mile walk. We also now know it's night and dark. It's probably not safe. It's probably not a good idea. But that's their immediate response. They're like, we have to get the message to the disciples in Jerusalem. They have to know he really is alive, that we've seen him with our own eyes. They have to tell them. And they do that because they're absolutely convinced. And the challenge for us is, are we convinced? Are we convinced? Do we have that burning within us? And, you know, do we have that same conviction about the resurrection, about Jesus being alive? Because that is a powerful message. If we really get it, it's a powerful message. They knew that. The apostles knew that. All through the Acts of the Apostles, just after the Gospels in the Bible, it is filled with them talking about the resurrection. That message absolutely dominates all of their teaching. They can't stop talking about the resurrection because it's a powerful message to the world. It was then, and it is today. The resurrection, it's the message of hope. It's our hope that there is more, that this, you know, isn't going to be the end, that when we die, we don't really die. The message of the resurrection, it's a bit like a receipt. And, you know, when you go into a store, you go shopping, you got a load of clothes, you come out, every now and then, maybe a security tag hasn't been taken off properly or something, but the alarms go off, and maybe you stop, and if they're on it, there'll be a security guard who comes and asks you what's going on, and checks your bags. But if you've paid for them, and you've got the receipt, you can say, it's all right, sir, I've got the receipt. I can prove that, you know, it's been paid for, it's all fine, don't you worry about it. And that's a little bit what the resurrection is like. It's a little bit like this giant receipt just stamped across all of human history saying, it's okay, it's paid for. Jesus paid for everything. And we now have the right, as children, to come into God's presence. And it's just very exciting. It's just very exciting. And Before we move on, because we are going to have communion. Before we move on, I just want to say, you know, if you don't have that burning within you, if you're not sure you have the receipt, or if you're not sure that God loves you, because that is where this starts. We can't really possibly hope to be truly generous if we're not sure that God loves us. If you don't have those things, I beg you, grab someone after this service to pray with you. I'm happy to pray with you, because until you have those things, nothing else matters. Nothing else matters. I think that's my challenge today. But we are, as I said, going to have communion. And I think this we can see this as a response. We can say, because we need to be generous. We need to be generous to God. And it's the only appropriate response to his love, being generous to God. And as we're generous to God, as that grows, our generosity to other people grows. It becomes natural and normal. It overflows out from us. But we all have areas of our lives where we are selfish, where we are generous. And I'm not going to point those out to you. I don't know what they are. You probably know what those are for you. It might be starting something new. It might be that you need to give something up. It will almost certainly involve a change in lifestyle, trying to become more generous. We can't just stay living the same way. But maybe you need time to think about what that might be for you, how you might be able to be more generous. With your time, with your money, with your gifts, with your hospitality, whatever it is, any part of your life.